So I didn't quite think this would actually get a chance to happen, because we're planning to go on a trip to Michigan this July, so we're trying to save money. But going to go see Alien Covenant, luckily, so happy about that. I mean, I have not actually sat to see a horror film in theaters, so I'm really looking forward to it. Plus, seeing an alien film in theaters is awesome, so I'm super looking forward to this. I just watched Alien, Aliens, and Prometheus. I'm going to talk about those briefly a little later after the vlogging, when we get to the review. So, I'm going to go check out Alien Covenant and show you guys around. It's going to be great. Here we go. And honestly, there's not much to show. There's not much changed. It's all the same posters.
What?
It's all the same posters still, so I already filmed it.
Okay.
So, show the theater going in. That's the greatest movie coming out.
What happened here?
Okay, so I got back about an hour ago, got all settled in, didn't feel like moving my computer, so if it's a little noisy, sorry. But let me just say real quick, we're gonna get into spoilers at the end of the video, and I'll let you know when, but for right now, you're safe from spoilers, and I'll be good. So let me just touch on, for hopefully another 30 seconds, Alien, Aliens, and Prometheus. So okay, first off, Alien is one of the most fantastic science fiction films ever, one of the best horror films ever made, and I love the suspense that it builds, and I may arguably like the first half better than the second, because I like the build-up and like the characters, but also like all the stuff with the xenomorph is really cool and it's awesome. Aliens is one of the best action films ever made. It really is, and it's one of the greatest science fiction films ever made. And do I like it better than Alien? Maybe. They're pretty on par for me in the same because they're so different, you know? So, they're really fantastic. I love Ellen Ripley. She's great. Sigourney Weaver is fantastic. I love the robot Bishop. I always get angry at Ash in Alien. Aliens, Bishop's great. I wish we could have seen more Bishop, but actually, the android Bishop. So, Prometheus, finally. Here's the thing. You want to watch Prometheus right before you go see Alien Covenant like I did, because they do have plot from Prometheus that they carry over, and you could argue they wrap up to further this story of the creation of Alien. Now, I'm going to go ahead and tell them, or maybe I shouldn't. I don't know. No. It's, you see it in the trailer. It may be brief, but it's in the trailer. You gotta know, there's two types of alien. There's the xenomorph we all know, and there's the protomorph, which is what you saw pretty much at the end of Prometheus, but when it's birthed from a human. So, you're gonna get that, and if you, some of you haven't watched the trailers, and I just won't go into it, that's fine. Just, even though it's fair game, I'm not gonna go into it anymore, because that's pretty much where you touch on. The cast is great. Catherine Waterson was great as Daniels. I want to see more of her, and she did a fantastic job. Danny McBride did not play up comedic at all. He, if you were worried, like, hey, we're gonna have, like, this, like, super funny, maybe raunchy character in an alien film? No, I don't want that. He's actually really serious, and he's one of the best parts of the film. He plays Tennessee. He's a really cool guy, and these characters must be good because I remember their names. The rest I don't. And that's not because they're bad characters. It's just because this is an alien film, so of course people will die. I won't say who, but, you know, people will go left and right when there's an alien around. So it's really cool, and Michael Fassbender's character is fantastic. He's my favorite part of the film, all around. Whether he's doing this or that, if you don't understand what I would mean by saying that, you can check out my spoilers at the end of this, or you can go see yourself and figure it out, and then come back and see, like, what do you mean? You'll see. So, he did fantastic. He returns from Prometheus, and, it's just fantastic. He's really good, and, you know, there's a surprise cameo at the beginning that I thought was interesting. And just, like, seeing the letters of the alien title just flash on like they do in the original film, just, like, piece by piece by piece, like it's an alien language, and then it spells out Alien and Covenant. So it's really cool. They did that with Prometheus. Ridley Scott is just really good. So I heard mostly good reviews. I try to avoid reviews the best I can, and then I heard one, people I follow, Angry Joe, who I really love, he didn't like this film, and I still don't know why. I haven't checked out his review. I'm gonna check out the end of this. I couldn't see why he was so angry with this film. I thought the film was fantastic. Does that have problems? Probably, if you look into it, okay, if you didn't like Prometheus, here's the thing. I would say Alien Covenant is what you wanted Prometheus to be, because, you know, you got Xenomorph, and you actually get some more answers in terms of the origin of the species, but you still have some questions, like, as far as, like, with the, like, how you see in Alien when they discover the ship, we're like, oh, I want to know the backstory of that. So with Prometheus, you got to know what the species was that was sitting in that chair, but you didn't know how it got there. In Alien Covenant, you see how xenomorphs come to be, and you do learn a few more things, and that's it. It doesn't touch on everything, and it really sucks, because now I gotta wait for the sequel, and they are planning on making a sequel, provided this does good. Like, Alien Covenant has to do good in order for there to be a sequel, so let's hope we get a sequel. Now, I'm going to say right now, the house that I went to, the theater, was packed. It was packed. I'm actually going to put a screen cap from Fandango an hour before the film started. This is the seating. We were right here, and it was packed and more filled up, like, with the front row, and it's pretty much sold out. No one talked. No one talked. Nobody laughed at the jokes. Nobody screamed at the jump scares. I don't think that's the fault of the film at all. I think the film has very effective scares. I tend to stay silent when I get scared. So, the scares are effective. The humor is funny. It might be because it was late or something. I don't know. But just this audience, like, when we were heading out, I overheard people, and, like, people were really into it. They dug in. They were chatting about it. So, clearly, they liked the film. Just wasn't a lot of vocals within the screening. So, I mean, I guess that, I probably just got, some people would say lucky, yeah, I got such a quiet screening. So, there's that. There's no guarantee it'll be for your theater. But that's how it was, and people were just focused and locked in. And I'm going to say this film, the overall thing I would say is it's intriguing. It is very intriguing. I've been very much wrapped up in the alien lore lately, because I did just binge Alien, Aliens, and Prometheus last night and today, and it's been great. And I want to keep looking into it. I can't wait to check out whatever YouTube video comes out with Easter eggs and explanations, because then it'll wrap up things I don't get. There are some twists in this film that maybe you see coming, but then maybe your feeling of it dies down. You're like, oh, okay, so it doesn't. And it can just go out of nowhere, like, oh, you switch back and forward. So what you think may happen maybe doesn't, but then maybe does, and it's a fun time. It really is. So you guys can go check out this film. I would highly recommend it. It is, I would definitely put it as one of my favorites of the year. I would. And I would say that Alien Covenant gets 4 stars. Yep. Of course. You hear it from me. 4 stars. Well, hey, if you want to hear me review a film that I didn't give 4 stars to, go check out my King Arthur review. So go do that. Just guys, make sure you go see Alien Covenant, because I want to see the story of this continue, because where they leave you, you have further questions, and you have previous questions you had. Even if you did get some answers, you got more questions, so you really need the sequel that they set up for, and it's really intriguing what they're setting up. So I'm looking forward to it. Guys, please go out and support Alien Covenant so we get more of these. Now, granted, Ridley Scott already said he's going into production, but the studio might pull the plug, and that will result in him having to finance it himself, if he even can. So, that being said, guys, please go support it. It's great. Okay. Alright. Kira, right now, this is the point. This is the point you gotta stop. Spoilers. 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 So, going through this film, a lot of people die. First off, let me talk about when the protomorph infects not the captain, the dude that he's just like jolting around, and it bursts through his back, which that's not the only way it comes out. You see with the other dude, it comes out his freaking mouth. It's disgusting. So yeah, really, really worth the radar. So right, was it needless? I wouldn't say so. I think it's a more creative invasion of the uncomfortableness that these creatures do, that they birth from. Which, why are there no nice aliens, you know? Like E.T.? Like, we don't get any of those anymore. Everything's hostile. This is, of course, Alien, but come on, can we run into, like, one thing? No, everything's like a pathogen and parasite. So, whatever. So, when the dude dies and the chick's stuck in quarantine, the other chick, I'm sorry, I can't remember the names. Tennessee's wife is, like, freaking out and can't do stuff. I'm like, oh my god, let her out, she's gonna die! And sure enough, she does, and then she does, and she's, like, firing at the protomorph, and the ship that's going explodes, and it's like, what? Come on! No. And you find out it's Tennessee's wife, and it's like, that sucks so bad, because I'm rooting for Danny McBride. He's a really hilarious actor, and he's a great character in this, so I was rooting for him, and it sucks he lost his wife. And, like, the whole time, he's thinking, hey, my wife's down there, even though she's already dead, and we know he's gonna find out. It's kind of heartbreaking. But let me talk about Michael Fassbender. So, he plays David and Walter. So, we got a flashback, with the creation of David, with Guy Pearce back. You know, he played old prosthetic makeup man, Waylon, in Prometheus, but then he's back in his young form with the creation of David, and it's actually kind of cool to see. I actually really dug it. Like I said, this film is very intriguing. I really dug it, so I'm trying to keep a steady pace of thinking and talking. I don't want to, like, go, so anyway, it's really cool to see the creation of David and how he saves the crew, but, you know, he's saving it to, you know, experiment on it. And David has been experimenting, I'll continue with that. David creates the Xenomorph. David creates it. He actually studies it, and he actually developed the egg that the facehugger grows in. And so, the captain of Covenant is the first person in human history to get latched on with a facehugger and birth a Xenomorph. And something that's so vile and disgusting coming out of a human being, you hear the beautiful grace music of newly birthed life to this being of generational terror. That's how I'm describing it, because David's just, like, looking at it, and you got the beautiful music playing, because it's all birth of life, and David's just there, like, holding up his hands to just guide, and the Xenomorph does the same, like, oh, father, or mother, I don't know. Interestingly enough, they use the computer program Mother in this, which is what they use in Alien, so I thought that was intriguing. And I wasn't worried it was gonna turn, because, you know, they're still using the Alien, and it's fine. The only problem was Ripley didn't make it back in time to stop the explosion of Nostromo. So, there's that. But, hey, David creating the Xenomorphs was really cool. The little baby Xenomorph is not what I expected it to look like. Mainly because it looked a lot thinner. Mainly that's just because, like, whenever it comes out, it's always, like, queued up like this. It's all stuck together. Its head is always slicked back. And it's just, like, this one little tube. But this one, it was, like, fully articulated, thin, braille, I don't know the term. Just thin, open arms, and, you know, the head, like, instantly came up. And it's like, dang, man, that's just a mini Xenomorph. That's creepy. It doesn't even look big enough or thick enough to, like, burst through it. So, how to do it? But that's just how it was. The first Xenomorph has to be shown in its entirety and its beauty of life. So, it's disturbing, but also enchanting? Because you're just focused on, like, this is the birth of terror. This is, oh my god. So, that's really cool. Walter, I want to touch on Walter, because he was really cool. I like how he had a different accent compared to David. David was more, British, I'd say. And, Walter is more low-toned American. So, he was really cool. They have a fight with each other. They meet quite a lot. And a lot of the times, I'm not even thinking, like, hey, this is an actor acting with himself. It's just, we've seen it so many times, it's the norm now. And I think that's really cool. We've come a long way in visuals. And speaking of visuals, there are sequences of the Xenomorph that is clearly CGI. Clearly not in a bad way. I'm not saying it like, oh, it's so obviously CGI. It's just, you know, it's CGI because no human in a suit could or even a puppet really on a full set could physically move as fast as the Xenomorph does when it's like maneuvering through a tunnel with a ladder that you have to climb down through the hull of the ship. It's like, and it jumps around a lot, so you know, like, no actor was in a suit performing that. Especially with it being so thin and whatnot. But it was really cool to see, like, a Xenomorph in its... This is probably, like, the fastest and slickest and most, like, able and capable Xenomorph of moving that we have ever seen. And it's probably just, like, the best we've ever seen it. And it's really, really cool. I fix my hair a lot in these reviews. I'm sorry. it's really cool to see. Like, oh my god, this is the peak of its prime. Oh my god, that's terrifying. It really is. It's cool to see. You know, it's got the mouth. And it's all the things you love. You sick creeps. You love it. but it's really cool. They did the switcheroo at the end, where, and I knew they were gonna do it, but here's my thought process. I was, when David was cutting his hair, I was like, well, first off, I was like, oh, I didn't know synthetics could grow hair. I'm not overly familiar with how synthetics work. But when he came face to face with Walter, I was thinking to myself, oh my god, he's gonna kill Walter and take his place on Covenant. And after their first scene of, you know, the flute and stuff, which I was really hoping when they were playing the flute, they would play the theme from Prometheus, because I thought Prometheus had such beautiful music. That's probably my favorite thing about Prometheus, was the music. The visuals, secondly, and then, first off, the music. And then, like, later, David does play the Prometheus theme on the flute like I hoped he would, and it made me so happy, because it's just, it sounds so hauntingly beautiful. It is just so good. So, when they have a fight, and, you know, it came down to them fighting, and, you know, David's, like, reaching for the knife, and Walter was going in for the final punch, it just cut away. And, of course, when they do something like that, you know, it just showed up, and it's like, oh, what happened to David? He expired. So, you think, okay, wait, are you David? And then you really get, like, taken into it that he's not, that he actually is Walter, because he's helping them out, and he actually is helping them to kill the Xenomorph. And it's like, well, David wouldn't do that. But then you see him monitoring the ship monitor, and, you know, closing different ports to trap the alien so they can kill it. And he's doing it, but as he's watching it, he's just like a little smirk. And I'm thinking two things. I'm thinking, one, that's David. Or two, Walter is convinced at what David said, and now he's going to turn on them. And I didn't want that to happen. I want Michael Fassbender. I love the actor. So I'm like, man, be a good guy. Be on our side. This is the good version. It's Walter. And here's the thing. Here's what my tell was. If Walter had a puncture under his chin, it's David, because Daniels stabbed it with the nail from how they would probably set up camp and, you know, build the log cabin and all that. And sucks you'll never get that. James Franco, by the way, that was interesting. So clearly he was more in the prologue, which that's intriguing. If you are watching spoilers, I'm gonna go over the Prometheus prologue that has Sean David that they released online. I'm going to do a full reaction to it, and we're going to talk about it, because I still haven't seen it yet, so that's going to go up after this. So anyway, I'm going to get back to my point. Just wrap it up here. Okay, so he looked up, like he just sat back and looked up, and it's like, oh, there's nothing there, and he still's got all these scratches, but nothing's there. So it's like, oh, okay, it's Walter, because Walter wasn't punctured there, David was, so it's Walter, we're all good. And it put him in the cryo sleep, and she's like, oh, David, Walter, will you please, like, when we get there, can you help me build my log cabin? And he's just like, it's like, you know, log cabin. David? It's, God, no! And yeah, it's David, he's like, don't let the bed bugs bite. I'll tuck in the children. He's so creepy, but elegant. Ugh. I hate it, but I love it. He seals, like, she's freaking out, but she's already in the process of cryosleep, so she just, like, freezes. There's nothing you can do. David takes control of the ship, plays the song, has Mother play the song that he played at birth, and they open the embryos, because it's a colonization ship, so you got all the embryos. Opens it up and places, that's what he does, two face hugger embryos, so he can probably grow more, eggs out of that, if that's how it works. If maybe they form the egg around it like a cocoon and then they come out, or if it's just going to grow into a face hugger on its own, I don't know. But here's the thing. Here's what left me kind of angry. I don't have my answer. I don't have my answer of how the ship crashed to LV-426 in Alien with the space jockey and the cargo of eggs. Because here's the thing. Here's my freak out. You have the ship crashed. Okay? Granted, they did not name the planet that we were on in this. But I don't think... I feel like if there was a full city with decayed engineers, they would have discovered by aliens. Because in Aliens, they've colonized LV-426. So they would have run into that by now. Or maybe not, because, you know, they didn't discover the original ship that they discovered in Alien. So there is that. But I feel like it looked way different. Because there was a lot more, you know, water and hills. And it was more beautiful looking than decayed, rocky LV-426. So they didn't name the planet, so I don't think it was LV-426, even though they may set it up to be. I don't think so. Also, in Prometheus, granted, we get to find out what the space jockey is, and it does have a burst out of its chest, but it's not in the pilot seat. It didn't crash on LV-426, it still crashed on LV-223. And what birthed from it was a protomorph, which is fine. It didn't have to be a xenomorph. But the cargo it was carrying wasn't the eggs. The eggs weren't even in existence yet. It was the vases carrying the black goo, which David unloaded on the entirety of the engineer population and wiped out a species. Can we just talk about how David committed genocide? Anyway. So, there's that, and the eggs were not created until David creates them in Alien Covenant. So, I want to know, is there another horseshoe ship? I don't know what it's called, the engineer ship. I'm just going to call it the horseshoe. Is there another horseshoe out there with another surviving space jockey? And is it going to carry a bunch of xenomorph eggs and going to transport it to somewhere? And then crash on LV-426? It's like, I don't get it. Why did Ridley Scott have it do the crash if it just crashed on LV-223 and not LV-426 and not have the eggs, yet still had the chest burst, but wasn't in the seat? I don't get it. I really hope he finds a way to wrap it up and connect it to Alien like we actually wanted to see at the end of Prometheus, which I dug Prometheus, but I really wanted that to happen. Alien Covenant, I don't get it. I've stressed this enough. You get it. My hair is crazy. I'm gonna wrap this up. Guys, I still love Alien Covenant. I really want the answer. I want to see how it happens, how it crashes on LV-426 and gets the events of Alien. I want to see it. And, you know, maybe people like Star Wars who are like, eh, we don't want it all connected. I do. I don't want to see it in some random comic. Like, we were already promised it in Prometheus, and that was the driving force of Prometheus for us to see it. Let's see it. So, Alien Covenant is planned to get a sequel, so I'm looking forward to it. If you guys are too, let me know in the comments below. Let's chat about it. And yeah, guys, that's it. If you enjoyed my review, hit the like button, subscribe if not already, check out my other reviews right here, and subscribe to the channel. Already said that. That being said, guys, hope you had a great day. I'm gonna decompress and do some research. May the Force be with you. Always.